because the office doesn't look anything like it did when I started 28 years ago. I know I'm getting old, but what we've done in the state's attorney's office in the last 8 years has been some great new innovative programs. One of the things about keeping the county safe, and that's our number one concern, is keeping all the residents of Cook County safe. Now, no matter where you live, we all want the same thing, right? We want our children to be safe going to schools, going to a church, going to a park, no matter where you're at. You deserve that as taxpayers of Cook County. We have to continue to make sure that we're doing our best to combat violent crime. Yesterday, I just did a press conference on a horrific, horrific domestic violence case where the woman was beaten to death with a hammer and dismembered, and her body stuffed in four different suitcases and thrown into the river. A horrific, horrific crime. It's also a reminder of how vicious domestic violence cases can be. We have to be tough on crime. And I've had new initiatives in order to keep our kids safe. Increasing the amount of time for a known gang member caught on the street with a loaded weapon. And when we look at the violence that's covering the city of Chicago, we also have to make sure when we look at the system as a whole, are there things that we can do better? Are there things that can make the justice system work better? And one of the things that I learned when I took over, and in fact it happened right here in Proviso in the first election, we had our first forum in this very room. And when I left in the parking lot, a man stopped me and he said, "You know, I really miss your community prosecution's offices," because we had them and we closed them due to budget concerns. Because it was a room, he sat on my advisory committee, and he said it was a really great way to connect with the community, and he's absolutely right. So I'm very proud that I've opened four community justice centers, one in Oak Park, one in the center of the city, one south, one north in the city, but I want to open more, and that's my goal, is to open more community justice centers. And those offices are storefront offices manned by my attorneys. We handle cases. People can walk right in and ask a question, handle a case, work with the community, work with the police department, work with community groups, do training for seniors, training on gun awareness, gang awareness. Those are the things that my assistants do. There was a study done by the University of Chicago. They chose Chicago, they chose my office, to look at how effective community justice centers are, and their study concluded that community justice, community prosecution works, and certain number of crimes are reduced as a result. So that's my goal, is to increase the number of community justice centers. We also have to make sure that while we need to be tough on crime, we have to be smart on crime. And how is it that we can be smart on crime? Well, that's looking at that population of criminals, and not criminals, people who find themselves into the system, find their way into the system because they made one stupid mistake. What can we do to make sure that these people don't reoffend, don't come back into the system? And that is our deferred prosecution programs. In 2010, I started our felony deferred prosecution program. When I took over, there were only 8 alternative sentencing programs available. Now there are 30. I've increased it to 30. Our felony deferred prosecution programs works like this. First-time offender on a nonviolent crime. Okay, it gets arrested. They are put into a diversion program, and if they if they finish that program with no other arrest, then their case is dismissed. They avoid the felony conviction, and we all know what that does to someone who wants to get a job or go into the military. I started my new prostitution court to make sure that we're diverting out when it comes to women who are caught in that type of crime. Our deferred prosecution programs continue to grow. My brand new deferred drug prosecution program takes effect in a couple of weeks, and that is for felons, not just first-time felonies, but people who are caught with a felony possession controlled substance. We're going to be diverting those cases out, and the reason is because we want to get those people the help that they need, because we see those people who are addicts that come back into the system, and I think we're all better if we get them help and get them the services that they need as opposed to staying in the system. So, okay, thank you.
Okay, yes. Our next person that we're going to hear from is Kim Fox, keeping it in alphabetical order.
Good afternoon, and thank you so much for having us out here. It's great to be in Proviso. I actually lived in Westchester for a number of years and still have a house out here, so it's great to be back home. As she said, my name is Kim Fox, and I am running for Cook County State's Attorney. I had the pleasure of working at the Cook County State's Attorney's Office for a dozen years. And in those dozen years, I've worked in the Juvenile Justice Division, and I rose to become a supervisor after only 7 years in the office. Prior to working for the State's Attorney's Office, I worked at the Cook County Public Guardian's Office. And for those of you that don't know, that's the office that represents children who've been alleged to have been abused or neglected. So these are kids who've been physically abused, sexually abused, kids whose families have been torn apart either by drug addiction or mental health issues. And then lastly, for the last 2 years, I served as Chief of Staff to Cook County Board President Tony Preckwinkle. And in that role, I was responsible for our criminal justice reform efforts, as well as the administration of the second largest county in the country in a $4 billion budget. I've been out of law school for 18 years, and 17 of those years have been spent in the public sector. I believe in public service. Elective office is about public service. It's critical to me because I grew up as a recipient when Tammy Duckworth spoke of public servants. I grew up as a child of a single mother in the Cabrini Green Housing Project, where educational opportunities and employment opportunities were few and far between. And yet despite that, I had a mother who worked very diligently for me to have opportunities to get a good education and go to good schools, and it has been my obligation to give back. And why I chose to work in juvenile in particular was because we knew that when we look at criminal justice, when we see what happens at 26 in California, there's a path that goes through 1100 South Hamilton. That the kids that I talked about whose mothers were drug addicted or they suffered from physical or sexual abuse, we tend to see them not just as victims in the abuse and neglect system, but we also see them as defendants in our delinquency system. And we also see them as defendants in our adult criminal justice system. And so when we talk about criminal justice, when we talk about being smart on crime, it's being aware of who we are talking about. The defendants that we're talking about, we're not talking about bad people or criminals. We're talking about people whose circumstances have led them to either hurt or be hurt. And we're talking about communities that are destroyed when we take policies that don't take into account the totality of all circumstances. When we have policies from 1986 talking about mandatory minimums and what we do on drug crimes, and it's 2015 and we're finally saying it's time to roll some stuff back, that we're finally having a conversation a year out from an election talking about how we should be smarter on crime and how we should treat drug addiction as an addiction and not as a criminal act. That in 2015, for the first time, we're talking about marijuana cases not necessarily being cases we should call our courts with, when 3 years ago we knew that. In 2015, we have sitting President Obama talking about the need for criminal justice reform, and Bill Clinton talking about the egregious effects of the policies from the last 30 years. In 2015, Cook County is still slowly rolling its head out of the past and trying to look to the future. We deserve better. We deserve a criminal justice system that, yes, is concerned about keeping folks safe from violent crime. That is absolutely essential. But we also need a criminal justice system that talks about community and how communities feel safe. And how communities feel safe when they trust the systems that are there to protect them. And that trust comes with accountability, credibility, and transparency. And what I suggest to you all is that we know in Cook County that there are issues and there are concerns, and we haven't been on the forefront. And while we are now trying to catch up with where we know policy has been wrong for so long, we have work to do. I have the benefit of having been a frontline prosecutor, and I did very well there, and been an advocate for children who've been abused and neglected, and also being an effective leader for a large organization. And I'm also from the communities that we serve. So I ask you to consider me for your vote for Cook County State's Attorney, not because I'm entitled to it, but because I've worked for it,
not because it's, you know, my name should do it because of who I've worked for. My life is why I do this. My passion for this is because the people that we serve as a servant are the people that I come.
Thank you, and last but not least, Donna Moore.
Thank you. My name is Donna Moore, and I'm also running for Cook County State's Attorney. And I'm running because our criminal justice system, as I think we can all admit, is broken. And in particular, the State's Attorney's Office is broken. I am new to elective politics. This is the first time I'm running for office. I am free from political influence, and I am passionate about making the office fair and consistent for everyone. I am actually not a politician running for a job. I am an experienced lawyer, and I'm running to do a job. And while I'm new to politics, I'm not new to law, and I'm not new to prosecution. I'm a former assistant state's attorney, and I'm a former assistant United States attorney. I know how to investigate cases. I know how to charge cases. I know how to argue cases to juries, and I know how to get convictions of violent offenders and white-collar criminals. And it's important to me, when I was a prosecutor, I was taught that you are concerned with not only the integrity of your case, but you are concerned with the integrity of the system. And that's what makes you a good prosecutor, that you are fair, that you are accountable, and that you are transparent. And right now, what we have in our system does not follow those rules. People do not trust the state's attorney's office. And let me just give you an example. If you are related to the mayor and you hit somebody and they fall down and die, you are charged with manslaughter. But if you're not related to the mayor and you hit someone and they fall down and die, you are charged with murder. The state's attorney's office does not have people feeling that they are safe and secure in their neighborhoods. Last year, we had 2,600 victims of shootings. Half of those people were under the age of 25. We are not doing a good job keeping our community safe, keeping our young people safe, or keeping our children safe. People don't believe that the state's attorney's office understands justice, because the state's attorney will allow a low-level, nonviolent person who stole a Snickers bar to stay in county jail for months, and yet 75% of the people charged with illegal gun possession never see the inside of a jail cell. So what do we do about it? Well, if you elect me as the top prosecutor for Cook County, I will tell you that I will transform this office, the office from where I started my career, and I will make it not just a case processor, which is what it has become, but a true minister of justice, because that is what we need. I will make gun violence a top priority. We need to help our police officers and work with our police officers to get guns off the street. We have to figure out why thousands of our cases are getting dismissed every year. What can the prosecutors do to work with the police and other local law enforcement to make sure that that isn't happening? We're not doing a good job. What about our juveniles, our veterans, women and moms who are getting entangled in the system on low-level offenses, and we are not helping them rise above their mistakes? Thank you. So I have had a broad base of experience. I've been a prosecutor, I've been a public servant, I've been an attorney in private practice. And it is this broad breadth of experience that gives me a world view of how you dispense justice evenly and fairly and in harmony with the community. And that's what we need to bring back to the state's attorney's office. I appreciate it. Thank you for your consideration and thank you for your vote.
Thank you, ladies. And as I said, we have a question and answer period. Is that another question? Okay, the first question, and it's a two-in-one question, and you can respond in alphabetical order the same way we did. We can stay consistent. What do you think the state's attorney's role is in ending mass incarceration? And the second part of that question is, do you think your opponent has done enough in this matter?
I'll tackle it, and neither of my opponents have been running the state's attorney's office as I have for the past 8 years. We have done, as I indicated in my opening, a tremendous job with creating diversion programs. And that is the whole process and the whole purpose is to keep people out of the system. As we sit here today, we've had thousands of people on a program, an alternative diversion program, as opposed to being in jail, as opposed to ending up with a felony conviction. That's what we've been doing for the past 5 years, and we continue to grow those diversion programs. So that's what we've been doing in this Cook County State's Attorney's Office. I think we've done a tremendous job. Our office has been recognized nationally for our innovative prosecution programs that never existed. They did not exist in this office, certainly when I was a young ASA, and they didn't exist 10 years ago. They existed when I took over and created these programs. I intend to continue to increase these programs, to increase the amount of people that are on these programs so we can keep people out of the system.
Thank you. The state's attorney is correct. I am not the elected state's attorney. However, as chief of staff to Cook County Board President, we made bail reform reduction the number one priority of the time that I was there. Every day at 26 in California, we hovered around 10,000 detainees at the Cook County Jail. So bad, in fact, it was under a federal monitor for decades. So bad, in fact, that it had been under a federal monitor since the 1960s. When the president took office, she said, she got all the stakeholders together and said, how can we reduce the jail population? And the jail population is important because it is the bellwether of those folks that we're talking about with diversion. And everyone said that they wanted to do something and nothing happened. And so the president wrote a letter to the Supreme Court, a letter that I drafted, and we sat with the Supreme Court and the stakeholders, and despite for 4 decades not being able to make a dent in the jail population, with the intervention of the Supreme Court and the work of the stakeholders at looking at best practices in other communities outside of Cook County, we were able to reduce the jail population safely without causing harm or further harm to the public by 20% in 18 months. 20% in 18 months. And so the notion that you necessarily have to be the elected prosecutor, you have to be willing to work with others, to partner with others, but not just do programming by yourself. That when you're talking about drug diversions, we throw out in Cook County the more cases that are dismissed at the preliminary hearing stage that are than folks who are going through these diversion programs. There are about 8,000 folks whose cases get dropped after 3 weeks at the preliminary hearing stage, and we don't have that many people in diversion programs. And so when you partner with others, there are ways to work to end mass incarceration. Once, the first thing you have to do is acknowledge that it's a problem. And we have not heard that acknowledgement here.
The thing that I would like to point out is this. The legislature passed and the governor signed a few weeks ago something that they call Rocket Docket. And what Rocket Docket is supposed to do is to take folks who are in Cook County Jail on low-level offenses like criminal trespass to property or criminal damage to property and make sure that their cases get heard within 30 days' time. And my question when I heard that was, why did we need legislation to do that? Why wasn't the state's attorney's office the lead in getting rid of these cases, which most of which get dismissed but not before people are spending on average 25 days at Cook County Jail at a cost of $143 a day, which is costing us rough and tough $20 million that we could use for other programs like drug abuse, like mental health, like job training for our juveniles. So if in fact the office were doing something to help the incarcerations, we wouldn't have to have legislation to direct them to do so. The state's attorney's office can do a better job. It needs to be the leader in the criminal justice system and not sit back while others make policy to force it to do something.
Thank you. Okay, and I have one last question. This question is for Anita Alvarez. The Chicago police officer that murdered Flint Farmer was involved in 3 shootings in a 6-month period. He was caught on video shooting Mr. Farmer twice in his back as he's laid on the ground. Why did you not indict or prosecute this officer?
Well, this came from Gator. Well-written Gator. We investigated that case. We investigated very, very thoroughly. When you're looking at police shootings, you have to look at everything and tear everything apart. There was a video. The video did not show everything. The officer responded to a call of a domestic in which Flint Farmer had just beaten his girlfriend to unconsciousness as well as a 3-year-old child. The officer chased him. He ran as the officer came up the front. The defender ran out the back, and there was a chase that ensued. When he caught up to him, the offender Mr. Farmer had a, it turns out to be a phone in his hand, and it was dark, and he raised his hand to the officer, and the officer fired. When you investigate police shootings, you cannot make a split-second decision on those cases, because what you have to do is understand a lot. Not only do you have to understand the facts, the evidence, and the law, you have to understand the use of force model. How are officers trained? What are they trained? This particular use of force model of the particular department. You have to understand case law that I doubt either one of my opponents even know about, that controls the type of statements that can be looked at on a police officer shooting case, okay? You have to, it's a painful, painstakingly slow process. Why? Because you want to make the right decision. And in that particular case, I believe that officer followed every rule that he had been trained. Now, those cases, I know they generate a lot of emotion. I know they generate a lot of discussion. But sometimes a video doesn't necessarily mean that you have everything captured, and everything was not captured on that particular video. You didn't see everything. But I have a history of not being afraid to charge police officers when it is warranted. And I've proven to do it. I did it in the officer serving case. I did it in the sergeant who cold cocked a young man who was handcuffed on the south side in the King Giro case. I have a history of charging police officers that none of my other predecessors ever did. So I'm not afraid to make those decisions when it is appropriate. And it has to be appropriate, because police officers have tough jobs. They are our partners, and I have the utmost respect for the work that they do. They also have to make split-second decisions, but you have to understand the totality of everything, and they are not easy decisions. They're not decisions I'm going to make overnight, because you really have to do a thorough investigation, and I've done it. And I don't shy away from charging police officers if it's warranted. I do it. I have a proven record of doing it.
All right. Thank you, ladies. Once again, we don't have any more questions, but we'd like to thank Anita Alvarez, Kim Fox, and Donna Moore for your participation this afternoon. Thank you. Oh, I was asked a question. That's right. Keep me on point. You get exactly 1 minute to close. One.
We know that we have a problem with criminal justice in the country and here in Cook County. And this isn't a matter of attacking individuals and talking about people's individual credibility. It's an acknowledgement that we have a problem that's acknowledged on the highest levels of this government, but on the local level, there's a sense of denial about what's happening in Cook County injustice. And what I will say to you is that we have a tremendous responsibility to the communities that we serve. We have a tremendous responsibility in terms of bringing integrity and credibility to our system, that to somehow not acknowledge that there is a mistrust of our criminal justice system and that the state's attorney's office stands at the gate of what that credibility looks like will do us no good. In order for us to be a better union and to have safety for our communities and trust in our systems, you need a state's attorney who is there to fight for that. You need a state's attorney who is not eager to make sure that people don't believe that they didn't make mistakes, that you can acknowledge mistakes and that you can learn from them and move from them and implement policies to make the system better.
1 minute, thank you.
Thank you. You know, understanding is the key and the source of forgiveness. Compassion is the source of forgiveness as well. And while people, I firmly believe, have to pay for their mistakes, once they have paid for them for their mistakes, they need to be part of our community. We have to give them forgiveness and welcome them back so they can be productive members of our society, because most of the folks that we send to prison will come out. The thing we do have to be concerned about, of course, is not only our convictions, but also what's happening on appeal. We have many, many cases that are being overturned on appeal. Perhaps the prosecutors need to take a refresher course in the law and make sure that our convictions stick all the way through, not just at trial, but on appeal as well. So, as Ms. Fox said, we have a lot of problems. We need people who are willing to roll up their sleeves and figure out solutions. And that is my vision of justice that I will bring back to the state's attorney's office. Thank you.
I'm going to talk about something that neither one of my opponents have even uttered the word, and that is victim. The Cook County State's Attorney's Office is there each and every day to be in court to speak on behalf of the victims of crime, all victims of crime, no matter where you're from. You know, we are there holding the hand of that single mom who lost her only son to gang violence, to the little girl who's been brutally raped and beaten. That's who we serve each and every day. And we can never forget that is the job of the Cook County State's Attorney, is to be there for every victim that unfortunately has found themselves in a horrific position. Public safety is our number one concern. And doing everything that we do in the second largest office in the nation, and having the reputation that we, despite what my opponents might say, on a national level, we have been recognized for our innovative programs, for our human trafficking units. We are the national model when it comes to human trafficking cases. Numbers and statistics that have been thrown around that are incorrect. And you know, at a later time, when we have more time, I can fill you in on what the real numbers are. But I have a proven record as a Cook County State's Attorney, and I will continue to be your Cook County State's Attorney, and I thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. And good evening. We have Donna who's running for re-election. We have Kim Fox, who's running for election, and Donna Moore. So, ladies, we thank you for your time this afternoon. And I say that to say, I'm going to assemble our next group of panelists. We are now going to hear from the panel of the Cook County Clerk of the Circuit Court. And we have Honorable Dorothy Brown, who is running for re-election.